All right, as we start our program today, science and technology, we're going to use it here today during this session. It certainly impacts all of our daily lives. It impacts our industry and many aspects of the United States Golf Association. We use it in everything that we do. Our first speaker today is Dr. Matt Pringle, who lives that mantra every day as the technical director of the USGA Technical Standards Department. He's been with the USGA since the year 2000, and he works hard to use science and technology to preserve and enhance our game. So, Dr. Pringle.
Well, thanks so much, Kimberly, for that introduction. My name is Matt Pringle, and as Kimberly said, I work in the Equipment Standards Department at the USGA. And so my day job is really club and ball rules. And so I want you to keep those cell phones out, because I'm going to give you a quick little poll here. I want you to think about the equipment rules and decide how important do you think they are to your job. They're very important to my job and the people that I normally interact with. But I was kind of hoping you could take a stab at whether it was, you know, you think the equipment rules are really important to what you do on a day-to-day basis, whether they're kind of important or whether they're really not very important at all. So I just want to take a couple minutes to let you feed in, because I'm really curious to hear the results. Well, good. So it looks like we're kind of stabilizing here. Thank you very much, actually, for participating. This is really, really important. And I'm quite gratified to see that you do actually think, a lot of you actually think, that it is really important to what you do. There's for those of you, though, who think that it's only kind of important, or even for the eight of you who think it's not important, I want you to think about something. I've got a white ball here that's about 1.68 inches in diameter, and it looks like a golf ball, and it kind of is. But here's a picture of it, and I don't know if some of you are certainly old enough to know about this. Some of you are probably too young to know about this. This is a Cayman ball, and I don't know if you know anything about the Cayman ball, but back in the 80s, Jack Nicklaus got asked to build a golf course in the Cayman Islands, but he didn't have enough room to have a golf course. And so he went to McGregor Company and said, hey, can you come up with a golf ball that travels a lot shorter than the current golf ball? And they came up with the Cayman ball, which did exactly what it was supposed to do. It goes a lot shorter than the current golf ball. But it wasn't necessarily a great golf ball, and so I don't think it got a lot of good response. But the point here is that I want you to think about if the golf ball didn't go for the professionals 300 yards, if it went 200 yards, and if it didn't for your regular golfers, if it didn't go 200 yards, if it went, 120 or 140, think about how profound an impact that would have on how much golf course you have to take care of. And that can be both good and bad. And so when it comes right down to it, how far the golf ball goes and how far the golf clubs of today go, those really do profoundly impact your day-to-day life, and so I would hope that you would, you know, make sure that you keep in tune with all of the goings-on that we have in the equipment rules side. Now, one thing I've noticed when I talk to people or when I read magazine articles is that a lot of people think that the way the USGA makes equipment rules is a bunch of old guys in blue blazers are sitting around a smoke-filled room, and they're putting their thumbs up or down to various pieces of equipment. And I want to impress upon you that couldn't be further from the truth. Really, it looks more like Dr. Frankenstein's lab, and I'm proud to be a part of that along with a really great team. We have in the Equipment Standards Department, we have sort of three guiding principles. That we have one set of equipment rules for all levels of play. That we preserve some of the tradition of the game so that Bobby Jones would still recognize a golf club today. He might say, why are drivers so big? But I think he'd still recognize it as a driver. As an engineer, though, the big thing that we focus on is challenge and preserving the challenge of the game, because I think anyone who plays the game understands that frustration aside, that part of what keeps us coming back is the fact that it isn't that easy, that it isn't that straightforward to hit a golf ball. And that's what makes it all the more satisfying when you do actually lace it down the middle. Our department has three PhD engineers, a couple of masters, and a couple of bachelor's engineers. We have a full test technician staff, even a machinist. The USGA spends over $5 million a year administering the equipment rules with our partners, the RNA in St. Andrews. Now, why do we spend all that money? You know, Major League Baseball pretty much limits the technology of bats by saying the bat should be made of wood. They limit the technology of balls by saying it needs to be cork or rubber wrapped in yarn and then wrapped in rawhide. Those are pretty easy to administer rules. But we don't do that at the USGA. What we try to do is thread a needle of limiting performance but allowing for the innovation of the equipment, because there's just been a long tradition of that since the game's beginnings, of tinkering with equipment and trying to tune your equipment to fit your game. Now, we have to do this, and the way we do this is very important. And one of the reasons we take on such a burden is that when you look at Here's a chart of patents. These are patents that have been applied for since the beginning of time till about 2010. You can see that, you know, you can see how all the sports line up here, with swimming kind of taking the lead. Now, where does golf fit into that? It's more than all the other sports combined. There's such a rabid interest in equipment innovation in golf that it takes, you know, a little bit of effort on the USGA and RNA's part to thread this needle of allowing innovation but trying to make sure that we preserve the game and protect the investments that all of you work on every day, the golf course. So how do we do that? Well, before I go into the details of how we administer and test and develop new equipment rules, I wanted to point out some of the easy ones. So here's a golf club that's got a 22 caliber charge in it, like your nail guns to propel the ball. And I think everyone here could easily say, well, that's not conforming. Here's a putter with lasers on it. Well, that's easy to define. Well, that's not conforming. That's, you know, clearly beyond the scope of the rules. And then here's a ball with ball bearings and springs in it. These three examples, these are easy to decide whether or not they conform. It gets a little trickier, though, when you start to get down to the nuanced things, like, for example, what groove shape should be conforming or not conforming. Now, these have real impacts on the game. They're measured in tens of thousands of an inches, and they can make a big difference to how the game is played. So I wanted to kind of give you some insight about how we went about looking at this particular topic, you know, as an example of the way we try to do things at the test center. So the first thing we did is we had a hypothesis, and the hypothesis was that grooves today, or in 2009, for example, didn't behave like they did in 1980. And so what we did is we went out to the field and we paid professional golfers to hit balls from the fairway, from the rough, from a variety of lies, and took a lot of data. And we determined that, in fact, you could see differences between sharp U grooves with modern golf balls compared to V grooves with Torbolatas, for example. So then we go in, and well, this is clearly self-explanatory. I don't really have to describe this. The point here, I don't want to go into what these graphs show, but the point here is that in addition to the field work, now we go back to the lab and go back to our computers and really try to fundamentally understand the physics that are going on with the golf ball and the golf club during those, you know, 500 millionths of a second that the golf ball and golf club are in contact. So what we do then is we develop, in this case, a series of test specimens, we did over 100 different types of groove shapes, and we can mount them then to our lab fixture, and we can shoot balls at that, and we can shoot it with grass in the middle of it or with dry, and we can take a whole bunch of data and see whether or not the performance lines up with our theory, and in fact, we did a very good job of figuring out the theory. Then we need to bring it to how it actually reacts to the golf course. So there was an example of a long iron coming in with very little spin, and then here's an example of a short iron coming in with lots of spin. So we don't just think about things in a little ivory tower in Far Hills, New Jersey. We try to take it from how it plays on the golf course to the lab and to the models and to the understanding, and then take it back to the golf course and see how what we're doing is affecting the game as it's played. And then in this particular case, we even took it one step forward further and involved PGA Tour and the LPGA to really test what we ultimately decided to be the new groove rules. And in fact, you know, it was easy to see. Here's an example of Joe Ogilvie and then former world number one Kari Webb hitting golf balls for us out of the rough and proving that the groove rules that we instituted at the time were actually doing what we wanted them to do. So again, this isn't a smoke-filled room with some old guys in blue blazers making rules. This is us trying to do our due diligence, you know, to fundamentally understand what's going on and put in place measures that control what we want to control, but yet give the manufacturers some flexibility about how they want to produce their product. Now, since that, we don't just throw out the new rules and then go away and wash our hands of it. We've been monitoring, for example, lots of things, but for example, how things are playing out on the PGA Tour. And one of the driving factors for us even considering new groove rules was when we looked at what's called the accuracy versus moneyless correlation. And the way this works is that in 1980, there was a very good connection between how accurate of a driver you were on the PGA Tour and where you ended up on the money list. So I could, if you were an accurate driver, I could tell you that you had a good likelihood of being high in the money list. In the 90s, that went down, and in the 2000s, it went down to zero correlation, maybe even negative, which meant not only was being an accurate driver not important anymore, it might even be working against you. And so you can see that trend. Now, since we put in the groove rules, I can tell you that that trend is no longer in place. I can't say statistically that we have reversed course, but I can certainly see very hopeful signs that trend has been broken and that maybe we're returning to where we were in the 90s. And so in the last, since we put in the groove rules, driving accuracy has returned to be an important part of predicting where you're going to end up on the money list. So that's very a very important finding. Another measure of whether the new groove rules have made any difference is to look at, for example, the average accuracy rank of the top 10 money winners on the tour. So in the 80s, the average rank of the top 10 money winner was around 50. And you can see that got worse. In the 90s, it went down to around 70. And then in the 2000s, it went as low as 110. So the average, in the 2000s, the average driving accuracy rank of the top 10 money winners on tour was 110 out of about 200. And you can see that since we put the groove rules in, though, that average has come back to where we saw it in the 90s. And then another measure, which we're able to take because the PGA Tour has their shot link system, which collects the location of virtually every shot played on the PGA Tour, which means since they instituted in 2004, we've got 10 million shots that we can look at. We can mine that data and we can say, okay, prior to the groove rule change, how many shots tended to go past the flag significantly? So in this case, 10 yards past the flag. Prior to the groove rule being implemented, about 3% of the shots did that. So we don't know that they're flyers, but we would say that that's probably a strong indication of the number of flyers that were hit. Since the groove rule change, though, we have increased that number by over 50%, and we see that very consistently year to year since the groove rule change. So there's signs out there that all the hard work that we put into understanding how groove shape affects the flight of the golf ball from shots from the rough have actually had an impact on the PGA Tour and hopefully the way we introduced the groove rule for the rest of us who don't play on the PGA Tour and all of our USGA championships has been pretty much benign to us because we weren't forced, our clubs didn't overnight become non-conforming. So that what I wanted to use the groove rule change for is just sort of an example of how we go about trying to do our job. And we do that in everything we do. And as another example, we wanted to look at how does the face geometry of drivers affect golf shots. So what we did is we did some modeling, both some basic modeling and some computer modeling. And then we actually went into our machine shop, fabricated drivers, put them into the hands of recreational and professional golfers and tested them. And we gain a soup to nuts understanding of, I hope, of how golf clubs and golf balls work and how what ramifications they have on the game. I would also like to point out, because this is very important to you, is that prior to probably the last 5 or 6 years, I think that the USGA and NRNA has had a very, the equipment rules have been very focused on the playing of the game and how does it affect the competitive nature of the game. But as my Cayman ball example demonstrates, you know, clearly the equipment rules have a profound effect on the business of the game. And I think that, that over the last 5 years, we've become much more cognizant of that. And I think you're going to see that more and more as we discuss rules going forward, is not only how does it affect the playing of the game, but how does it affect the business of the game and the sustainability of the game. And that is going to be a central pillar, I think, to making decisions on new equipment rules as we go forward. We've also, I'm proud to say, discovered the answer to the age-old question of what happens to a Dunkin' Donuts munchkin when you hit it against a steel block at 100 miles an hour. And it's fantastic. And I can tell you it made a hell of a lot more mess than we ever thought it was going to. So we were cleaning up for weeks after that. I mentioned that we this is not to brag, although I'm going to brag a little bit, because we have a heck of a staff. The USGA spends a lot of money on research on equipment. But the good thing is that the USGA also has a resource in the test center that goes beyond just equipment rules. It's a scientific, with us in the green section, we have a lot of scientific experience and knowledge at the USGA. And so we've been starting to apply that more and more to things that aren't equipment related. And the True Firm is an example, and I'm really pleased to talk about it because this is one of my little babies. And that was an offshoot of we needed a tool in the equipment standards department to look at fairways and to measure some firmness characteristics of the fairways so we could better predict how far balls would bounce and roll once they hit the turf. But at the USGA, we quickly became sort of aware that this would be a good tool to characterize greens for championships. And since then, we've licensed that product to our friends at Spectrum, and now you can buy it too. We are now lending our knowledge and experience more and more to using golf and the science of golf as a tool for helping get kids interested in science and technology and engineering and math. And that's been a very exciting project for us. We've been partnering with our friends at Chevron to develop the STEM zone at our championships and at other golf tournaments. We've been doing a lot of videos, the NBC Learn program. We've been doing a lot of videos on the physics and science and math of golf, along with the green section. And so now this becomes part of the curriculum for science students from the little kids up to college, and teachers can lean on these resources as tools to help them get kids motivated to understand and get involved in science. Something that I've been working on quite a bit, as has the entire organization over the last year, has been to try to understand and find some solutions, some real-world solutions to the problem of pace of play. And the first question that I get asked a lot is, why are you as an engineer involved in pace of play? Because isn't it just, you know, coming up with these cute PSAs to tell golfers to, in essence, go faster? Well, the answer to that is that pace of play is an engineering problem, the same way that traffic congestion is an engineering problem. And the golfer is no more at fault and is no more the cause of poor pace of play than one of those drivers in the traffic jam is. And so we've been working hard to understand what's going on with pace. And I wanted to sort of try to give you, the causes of poor pace of play are many. But the fundamental one, the one that I would like to sort of emphasize to you a little bit today, and maybe give you some food for thought, is a very fundamental one, and if we could solve that part, that's the lowest hanging fruit. If we can solve that part, then we can all make a lot of impact on this problem from the recreational game right through to the professional game. And the problem is this. I want to give you sort of an analogy. If I've got a tank and I've got water flowing into it and I've got water flowing out of it, and those flow rates are balanced, what happens? The water comes into the tank and it goes out of the tank and there's no waiting whatsoever. That water goes in, it goes out. What happens if I start to pour the water in faster? What happens, of course, is that the tank starts to fill up. So now that water that I just put in has to wait. It has to sit in the tank, and eventually it flows out of the tank. And that wait gets worse. So when it's a quarter full, it's going to take, you know, X amount of minutes to, for that water to get out. When it's half full, it's going to take twice as long. When it's full, it's going to take four times as long. The same thing is true on a highway. The same thing is true on your golf course. If golfers are flowing onto the golf course faster than they're flowing through the golf course, then what happens? The tank starts to fill up, and those golfers have to wait. This is the most fundamental problem that we have, is this imbalance between golfers flowing on the golf course and flowing through the golf course. We have to achieve good pace, you have to strike a balance. Now, there's two ways to attack this, of course. Going back to our tank example, we can slow down the flow onto the tank, and we can slow down the flow into the golf course through good tee sheet management. The other thing we can do is we can try to increase the flow out of the tank, or in our case, the flow through the golf course. And the way we can do that, a bunch of our agronomists are going to talk to for some specific lessons to you guys in golf course setup. There's a whole bunch of things that we can do. But the primary thing we need to do is to have that good balance. This is my mathematical equation for good balance. And what it says, very simply, if we look at, for example, the fourth group of the day, what it says is that their round time depends on the round time of the group in front of them. It depends on the interval between their finishing time and my finishing time. And it depends on the interval when we started. And so this is just a mathematical expression of that balancing rocks on the slide before. We all have one of these in our house. If you want to control the temperature in your house, what do you have to do? You have to measure the temperature and you have to control the temperature. This is not rocket science here. So we measure and we control. On the golf course, we have to do the same thing. My wife's a chemical engineer, and I say, hey, what if DuPont wanted to run a plant with no measurements and no controls? And she just says, what's wrong with you? But yet, that happens on the golf course a lot. And the golf course is our factory, right? It's producing rounds. So we need to measure and control that. So how can you do that? Well, one way is my friends at GPSI and Club Car have been providing us with access to their data that they collect on their cart-based GPS systems. And we've been mining that to try to understand the state of pace of golf in not only America, but around the world, because they are international. And from that data, it's very easy to see what the flow rate is through the golf course and at any point on the golf course. The other way that we're doing that is we are going out, and you're going to see a lot more of these, with these little GPS data loggers that we've been buying, and we just stick them in the pockets of golfers and have them play and have them come around back to the 18th, and we pick them up from them. And we're able to get from that where they were on the golf course every 5 seconds for their round. And we can see then how they interact with the groups in front of them, with the groups behind them, and we can get a really thorough understanding. Now, you can also break this down even simpler. You can send somebody out with a stopwatch to the 18th hole, and you can say, time when each group puts the flag in the hole. That will give you a very accurate measurement of the flow rate coming off of your golf course. And I'm telling you that if the flow rate onto the golf course doesn't balance with the flow rate coming off the golf course, then your tank is filling up. And as that day progresses, and we've all experienced this, as that day progresses, the weight in that tank is getting worse and worse and worse for the golfer through no fault of their own. And so I would encourage you, it's very easy to do to take a busy day, a busy Saturday, and simply start to put a stopwatch on golfers as they come off. Now, this GPS logging device is a really neat tool. And what we're going to do is, you can see here that here's an example of one track of a golfer. And then, of course, we can look at a golf course after a whole day and see where all the golfers have gone. This happened to have been a shotgun start, so there's a lot of people driving their cart down the cart path to get to their various holes. But you can see where the golfer has gone. And this has ramifications not only for pace, but for a whole bunch of things. And Jim Moore is going to talk about that in a few minutes. But what we're going to do this summer, with our help from our friends at Chevron, is we're going to put 8 interns in the field around the country. And we're going to give them a supply of these GPS loggers, and they're going to go out to golf courses. They're going to go out to golf courses, and they're going to put them into the golfers' hands. They're going to collect some scoring data. They're going to collect some basic agronomic and environmental weather data. And we're hoping that by the end of this summer to collect tens of thousands of rounds on hundreds of golf courses all over the country so that we can start to correlate now the ramification of golf course setup, of green speed, of wind, of length, of golfer skill. All these things we want to correlate back to how does it affect the pace. And also to use that data to update our, for example, our course rating manual and to help the green section understand where do golfers go on a golf course and so to help give them some information on targeting, better targeting, maintenance practices, golf course layouts. And so we're going to target, the way this program is going to work is these 8 interns are going to be housed at different state and regional golf associations around the country. You can see that we're going to have one in Philadelphia, one in New Jersey, one in Virginia, Chicago, Denver, Seattle, Los Angeles, and we're hoping Dallas as well. And the folks at the IT department at the USGA are going to not like that I'm going to do this. But what I would like, what I think a central part of doing this program successfully is going to be getting enough access to enough golf courses to make this a very meaningful and robust program. And so if you're in any one of those areas and you think your golf course would be interested, and having us come out, again, this is very low impact for the golfer. All they need to do is stick a little gum pack sized data logger in their pocket and give it back to us at the end, nothing more. I would encourage you to write my email down and to drop me a line and say, hey, we'd love to have you do that. Because we're really excited about this program and we think it's going to provide reams of data that we'll be able to tap into for a whole bunch of different problems. Thank you very much. I think Dr. Kimberly is going to come back now.